to the one more video session of microcontroller and embedded system. This is Vasant Naik from Canara Engineering College. In this session, we will study about memory. Like in the previous session, we understood what are the core components inside the embedded system. The core components inside the embedded system are like microcontroller, microprocessor, and application specific integrated circuits, field programmable grid array, etc. Now we are focusing on memory, such as different types of memory that can be used in embedded system. So you cannot imagine, or we cannot imagine, an embedded system without memory. We know the memory is required to hold control algorithm of an embedded system. In other way, memory is essential for any embedded system because it holds control algorithm or logic. So the memory is an important part of a processor control based embedded system. The memories are classified here, or the memory is classified into like on chip memory. Second one is a off chip memory. So now, what is on chip memory? On chip memory is the memory which is built in inside the processor or controller. Such type of memory is referred as on chip memory. Now, what is off chip memory? Off chip memory is the memory which is external to the processor or controller. This memory is connected as external to the processor or controller. This type of memory is called as off chip memory. Other than on chip memory and off chip memory, there is also third class of memory, that is called as working memory, that is required to hold the temporary data which is produced during the processing of all the instructions, or during the operation of all the instructions. So this memory is called as a working memory. Now, so we'll see now what is a program storage memory, or ROM. So program memory, it is also called as code storage memory, which is used to store the code of the embedded system, which stores mainly program instructions. So this memory is classified into different types. Here the diagram shows the different types of code memory. So actually, code memory retains the contents even after the power to it is turned off. So code memory will retain the content even if you switch off the power. So different types of code memory, code storage memory, are: one is OTP, one time programmable ROM, or masked ROM, MROM, or EPROM, erasable programmable ROM, or EEPROM, electrical erasable programmable ROM, or flash, or we have something called as NVMe, non-volatile RAM. See, normally the RAM is volatile, but we have a separate category of RAM that is called as non-volatile RAM. This RAM can hold the content for maximum of 10 years, not more than that. That type of RAMs are called as a non-volatile RAM. So let me repeat. So memory is the vital part of any embedded system. So memories are classified into on-chip memory, which is built in inside the processor, and off-chip memory, which is external to the processor. Other than that, we have something called as working memory, which is a temporary memory. Then program memory, or code storage memory, ROM, which stores the instruction, and it can be, and it stores the instruction even if it is turned off, even if the power is turned off. So mainly this type of memories are used to store firmware. So we have different classifications here. One is one time programmable ROM, second one is MROM, third one is erasable programmable ROM, next one is electrical erasable programmable ROM, then we have flash, then we have NVRAM, that is non-volatile RAM. So non-volatile RAM also comes under this category. This will hold the information, not forever, it will hold the information at least to 10 years. We'll see what is the reason for this one in the later session. The first type of memory we are going to discuss is masked memory, MROM. It is a one-time programmable device. That means you cannot reprogram it. So this MROM makes use of hardware technology for storing data. By the help of metallization process at the time of production. So it makes use of the technology called as metallization process at the time of production. So by using this process, this MROMs are manufactured, and it is a one-time programmable device. It will be programmed at a particular factory itself. It cannot be reprogrammed by the it cannot be reprogrammed once again. So advantage is so low cost for high volume. See, if you go for high volume production, cost is less, and least expensive type of memory. It is the least expensive type of memory. So different mechanisms are used for masking process. Here it makes use of, as I said, masked memory, or MROM makes use of masking and metallization process. So different technologies or mechanisms are used in masking. That is, one is called as enhancement, and other one is depletion mode transistor. Creation of enhancement and depletion mode transistor through channel implant. See, we know actually from our previous electronics theory, there are two types of transistor. Like, one is enhancement and other one, two types of transistor mode, that is enhancement and other one is a depletion mode. In enhancement mode, no channel between source and drain, and in the depletion mode there will be a channel between the source and drain. This we studied in our electronics theory. So second one is other mechanism is by creating a memory cell either using standard transistor or high threshold transistor. So creating a memory cell by using standard transistor or high threshold transistor, just like MOSFET. So to create a memory cell, approximately 6 MOSFETs are required. This we will going to study in the later session. Now the application. So actually masked ROMs are good for storing embedded firmware. See, once the design is proven, like if the design is correct and the firmware requirements are tested and frozen, then binary data can be, that is firmware can be given to the MROM fabricator. The limitation of this one is it is a one-time programmable. That means it cannot be reprogrammed. That is, inability to modify the device firmware against the firmware upgrades. Suppose you are going to upgrade the firmware, it is not possible, because it is not possible to alter the bit information once it is programmed in the fabricator, with the fabricator. That is the problem. So second, we will see the second type of memory we are going to discuss here is one-time programmable memory, that is a PROM, one-time programmable memory, OTP. So here we are going to discuss programmable read-only memory, PROM, that is one-time programmable memory. So don't confuse this with the mask ROM. So actually mask ROM is programmed by one, it is also one-time programmable, but it is programmed by the fabricator. But PROM is programmed by the end user. So end user is responsible for programming. It is also one-time programmable only. That means it allows end user to program once only. So this PROM has got like nichrome and polysilicon wires. These wires are arranged in the form of matrix, and the intersection of these wires are called fuses. Suppose if I want to store one, then the fuses which are not blown or burned represents logic one. That is, if I want to store one, then fuses are not blown or burned. If I want to store zero, fuses are burned or blown. So these are the two things actually it uses to store. These are the two ways it uses to store, either one or zero. Second one is, so what is the application? So its OTP is widely used for commercial production of embedded system. It is a low cost solution for commercial production, but it has got limitation. It is not useful and worth for the development purposes, because during the development phase, the code is subjected to continuous changes, and using an OTP each time to load the code is not economical, because during the development the code changes continuously based on the development constraints. Then each time you need to have separate OTP for storing the firmware. It is not economical. So next we'll study erasable programmable read-only memory. Now the third category of memory is erasable programmable read-only memory. Actually, this gives flexibility to reprogram the same chip. That means the chip can be reprogrammed many times. So it stores the information by charging the floating gate of FET. Here it will make use of a field effect transistor. And if you want to store one, you need to charge the gate. You need to charge the gate of floating gate of FET. If you want to store zero, you need to discharge. So, erasable programmable RAM contains something called as a quartz crystal window for erasing the stored information. So, you can, if this window is exposed to ultraviolet rays for a fixed duration, the entire memory will get erased. So, that is a technique. So, it has contained a quartz window, crystal window. That window is exposed to ultraviolet rays for a fixed duration, then the content will get erased. So the limitation is even though this chip is reprogrammable, but in order to reprogram it, we need to take it out from the circuit board, and we need to put an ultraviolet eraser device. We need to put it in an ultraviolet eraser device for 20 to 30 minutes. So it is a tedious and a continuous process. So this can be overcome by one more type of ROM, that is electrically erasable programmable read-only memory. So here the information contained in the electrical erasable programmable memory can be altered by using electrical signals in the registers or bytes level. So they can be erased and reprogrammed easily in the circuit itself. In the earlier case, in case of EPROM, you need to take out the chip from the circuit board and you need to put it inside the ultraviolet eraser device, and you need to pass that ultraviolet light rays for 20 to 30 minutes. So such type of things are not required here. So the chip also includes erase mode. By using that erase mode, the content can be erased in a few milliseconds. Application is it provides a greater flexibility for the system design. But limitation is the limitation of this one is capacity. The capacity of this ROM is limited in kilobytes compared to the standard ROM. So if you take some standard ROM, this ROM capacity is limited in the kilobytes. So next one, we have something called as a flash. Flash is the latest ROM technology and most popular. So it is the variation of EEPROM technology. Like it combines the advantages of programmability of EEPROM and high storage capacity of standard ROMs. It combines the advantages of both EEPROM and standard ROMs. What is the problem with the electrical erasable ROM? That is, it cannot the capability is the capacity is the limitation. But it can be reprogrammed at any times by using the electrical erasable signals, right? So, this flash memory will combine the advantages of this electrical erasable ROM and standard ROMs, because the advantage of standard ROM is it will be available in a larger size. Flash memory is organized as sector blocks or pages. So once again, flash memory makes use of MOSFET transistors to store the information. Erasing of the memory can be done at sector level or page level. So each sector or page should be erased before reprogramming. So next one is non-volatile random access memory. So normally RAM is a volatile, but this type of RAM, NVRAM, is non-volatile because this type of RAM, random access memory, is with the battery backup. It contains a static RAM memory and a minute battery for providing supply to the memory in the absence of the external power supply. So this both memory and battery are packed together in a single package. So the lifespan of this RAM is for 10 years. For example, DSJ644 from Maxim is an example for 32 KB NVRAM. NVRAM means non-volatile RAM, because it contains small backup batteries there inside the chip itself. So that is the advantage. So students, we'll see now. The next one is read-write memory or random access memory. Actually, ROM is the code memory where the instructions are stored, and RAM is the data memory or working memory. It is like a temporary memory. During the processing of instruction, this is a temporary memory to hold the data. So RAM is volatile, and RAM is a direct access memory, meaning we can access the desired memory location directly. It is not like a sequential access memory. In sequential access memory, you need to scroll down to the particular location in order to access that location. So example, CD-ROMs and magnetic tapes, etc. So now, so RAM generally falls into three categories. One is called as a static RAM, SRAM. Second one is a dynamic RAM. Third one is NVRAM. You have already discussed about NVRAM. So now we'll see what is the difference between a static RAM and a dynamic RAM. Now, static RAM stores the data in the form of voltage. It stores the data in the form of voltage. You need to remember, static RAMs are the fastest RAM available. So static RAMs are made up of flip-flops. So for the implementation of the static RAMs, single memory cell requires 6 transistors or 6 MOSFETs. 4 of the transistors are form a latch or flip-flop, and 2 more transistors used for controlling. So it is faster because of its resistive networking and switching capability. So here you can see in the diagram, we have 6 MOSFETs or transistors make one memory cell. So you can see here, transistor MOSFET Q1, Q2, Q3, Q4, that is NMOS and PMOS, NMOS and PMOS. So this is NMOS and PMOS, and NMOS and PMOS. These 4 transistor forms the flip-flops, store either 1 or 0, 1 or 0. So you can see here, these are connected in a feedback way. So transistor Q1, Q2, Q3, Q4 makes the latch or flip-flop in order to store 1 and 0. And we have 2 more transistor for controlling this latch, that is Q5 and Q6. So here Q5 transistor and Q6 transistors are connected to word line, and we'll make word line I. That time both transistors are accessible, and these transistors can be controlled with the help of a bit line B bar or bit line B. This acts like input and output. Now you see here, like when you see this one, this NMOS and this PMOS, here gates are interconnected and sources are interconnected, and here also gates are interconnected and sources are also interconnected. So this gives the output to this one, this gives the output to this one. So these are connected in a feedback way. When you see this NMOS and this PMOS, it looks like a NOT gate. Similarly, when you see this NMOS and this PMOS, it looks like a NOT gate. So both NOT gates are connected in a feedback manner. That looks like, we'll go to the next slide and we'll see here. So if you see, if you take this diagram, this NMOS and this PMOS, these both MOSFETs are forming this NOT gate, and this MOSFETs are forming this NOT gates. Both NOT gates are connected in the feedback in order to store either data 1 or 0, like forever, in the sense like till the power is 1. And this both are controlled by two more transistors. So here you can see we have read control and write control. We have read control and write control. Suppose if I want to write, one, then what I will do is I will make write control is equal to enabled. I will make the write control enable. Then I will give here one. When you make the write control enable, this transistor can be accessed. When you give one here, this one comes here, and this becomes zero. So same zero goes to the other inverter and this becomes one. That means on this side we have one and on this side we have zeros. So this acts like a latch or flip flop, which can store either one or zero. And to read the data, you need to make the read control high. That time you can read the data. Suppose if you have two signals here, you will get one on this side and you will get zero on this side. Similarly, if I want to store zero, then I need to make the write control high and I will make zero here. So zero goes here, then this becomes one and this becomes one, and when you give one to the NOT gate, it becomes zero. That means zero will stored on this end and one will be stored on this end, and this remains till the power supply is on to retain the data. So this is the basic structures of a static RAM, and we'll see now. So here you need to remember the memory cell is controlled by the line word line, like that is a word line which controls the access of transistor Q5 and Q6. To write a value, apply the desired value to the bit control lines for writing 1. Make B is equal to 1 and B bar is equal to 0. For writing 0, you need to make B is equal to 0 and B bar is equal to 1. Similarly, for reading the content from the memory cell, like both B and B bar bits line to be 1 and set the word line to 1. These things you need to remember. So other than that, what is the limitation of this RAM? The limitation of this RAM is SRAMs are low capacity and high cost. Why it is high cost? I have already told you. To create one memory cell, it needs 6 transistor or MOSFETs. So if you want to create a larger memory, then it needs several transistors or MOSFETs. That's why it is I cost. Now we will move to the next section, that is dynamic RAM. Now students, we'll see dynamic RAM, DRAM. It stores the data in the form of charge. So these are made of like MOSFET transistors. Like here, it doesn't require like 6 transistors as in the case of SRAM. It requires only 1 transistor. The advantages is its high density, because it makes use of only 1 transistor, and low cost compared to SRAM. The disadvantage of this one is whatever the information stored here, the information stored in terms of charges, it gets leaked off with the time. In order to prevent this one, they need to be repressed periodically. So for that, there is a special circuit which is called as a DRAM controller, used for repressing the repressing the operations. So this repress operation is done periodically in milliseconds interval. So in milliseconds interval. So next one is we'll see here. See, like in the case of SRAM, we are using 6 MOSFETs, but here we are not using 6 MOSFETs. So here we are using single MOSFET, and there is a bit line P and word line, and we have capacitor. In order to see word line, you need to keep always high, and suppose if you want to store one, then you need to make the bit line 1. That time when you make the bit line 1, this capacitor will get charged and it will store 1. If you want to store 0, then you have to make this 0. That time this capacitor will get discharged. So with this, it will store 1 or 0. Now the comparison between SRAM and DRAMs. So SRAM cells made up of 6 CMOS transistor or MOSFETs, but here it is made up of single MOSFET and capacitor. So as here, SRAM cell does not require an repressing. Why it is not require repressing? We will go back to the earlier slide. You see here, it acts like inverter to not get connected in the feedback, to store 1 and 0 continuously. So that's why the feedback, that's why the repressing is not required. But here we are using the capacitor. So here there's a chance of charges getting leaked off. So there's a possibility of losing of the data. So we need to refresh this one. For that, there is a separate circuitry which is called as DRAM controller to refresh this one. So other than that, you see, doesn't require refreshing. It requires refreshing. It's a more expensive, it is a less expensive, and it is fast in operation, typically 10 nanosecond, but it is slow in operation because it needs refreshing and all. So typical access time is 60 nanosecond. It is a more expensive because more transistors are used. It is a less expensive. So last one is NVRAM. I told you, non-volatile random access memory with battery backup. It contains static RAM based memory and minute battery for providing supply to the memory in the absence of external power supply. So the memory and battery are packed together in a single package. So the year both memory and battery are packed together in a single package. So that's why it will give backup. Backup, like, in the sense, like, even though normally RAM is volatile, but NVRAM is non-volatile because of its battery backup. So the lifespan of NVRAM is expected to be around 10 years. That means you cannot store the data forever because this battery will get discharged. Whatever the battery inside the package, you will get discharged. That's why you cannot store it more than 10 years. And the example for this one is DSJ644 from Maxim. This one is an example for 32 KB NVRAM. So, dear student, you have seen different types of RAM, and that is SRAM, static RAM, dynamic RAM, and NVRAM. All these are called as a read-write memory. Other than that, we saw different types of ROM, that is flash ROM, programmable, one-time programmable ROM, mask ROM, EEPROM, electrical, erasable, programmable ROM, etc. All these are called as a code storage memory because it will store the code, but RAM will store the data during the operation. So in the next session, we will see what is read-write memory, random access. Memory according to the type of interface. Thank you for your cooperation. So we are discussing about different types of memory, and we know what are the different types of ROM classification and RAM classification. Other than that, memories are classified according to the type of interface, that is parallel interface or serial interface or serial peripheral interface. That is, in case of parallel interface, suppose there are data lines D0 to D7 for 8-bit processor, then processor or controller will be connected to D0 and D7 of the memory chip. So in that way, you need to select the memory. Serial interface, sometime it is called as I2C. It is a two-line serial interface used for data storage memory like EEPROM. Then we have something called as a serial interface, SPI, serial peripheral interface, where N stands for 2 plus N line interface, where N stands for the total number of SPI bus device in the system. And memory sharding. Actually, one more concept is memory sharding. So RAM access is about 3 times faster as fast compared to ROM. But then why we need sharding of memory? Sharding of memory is a technique adopted to solve the execution speed problem in the processor-based system. Normally, in a computer, there is a basic input-output configuration program which is stored in ROM. When you boot your system, this basic input-output system will be executed. But we know basic input-output systems are ROM. ROM access is slower compared to RAM access, and it is a time consuming. So in order to avoid that one, here what we do is something called as memory shadowing. In the memory shadowing, we will copy the content of the ROM to RAM. That is, during the boot up, BIOS is copied to the shadow ROM. So this is in order to improve the performance. Now, memory selection for the embedded system. So actually, the embedded system require program memory, data memory, and memory for holding non-volatile data. The memory requirement of our embedded systems in terms of RAM, ROM, flash ROM, NVRAM, etc. So there is no hard and fast rule for calculating the memory requirements. So you need to identify your system requirement and type of the processor which you are going to use, and you need to understand which type of memory is sufficient, like 1GB memory or external memory is required. For example, we will take a simple electronic toy design. So in this case, a microcontroller with few bytes of internal RAM is sufficient. Few bytes or kilobytes of flash memory is required. Few bytes of EEPROM is required. It does. There is no need of external memory. But if you are going to design an embedded system which is based on RTOS, that time RTOS required certain amount of RAM for its external execution and ROM for storing RTOS image. So RTOS image is normally stored in a flash ROM. During the boot up of the device, RTOS files are copied from the program storage memory and decompressed if required, and then loaded to the RAM. So always add a buffer value to the total estimated RAM and ROM size requirement. So here both ROM is required and RAM is required. Then the next one is Like the next example is a smartphone device with the Windows mobile operating system. Suppose we need to design a smartphone device with the Windows mobile operating system. 64 MB RAM and 120 MB ROM are the minimum requirements for running Windows mobile device. So in some cases you need extra RAM and ROM. So there are two parameters for representing memory, that is size of the memory chip and word size of the memory. Size of the memory chips are like 512 bytes, 1024 bytes, 1 kilobytes, 2 kilobytes, 4 KB, 8 KB, 16 KB, 32 KB, 64 KB, 128 KB, 256 KB, 512 KB, 1024 KB, 1 megabytes, that is 1 megabytes. Suppose your embedded application requires 750 bytes of memory, then you don't have option of getting 750 bytes of memory. You need to go for 1 kilobytes or 1024 bytes. And a processor or controller with 16-bit address bus you have, then it can address only 2^16, that is 64 KB. Hence, it is a meaningless if you select 128 kilobytes memory. It is a meaningless because that cannot be supported by the processor. So next one is the other parameters for representing memory is size of the memory chip and word size of the memory. So word size of the memory refers to the number of memory bits that can be read write together at a time. Normally word size is 4-bit, 8-bit, 12-bit, 16-bit, 24-bit, 32-bits are the supported word chips by the most of the memory. And in the embedded system design, flash memory is the popular choice for ROM. It is powerful and cost effective solid state storage technology for the mobile electronic device and other consumable applications. So with this student, I have completed the memory session. In the next session, we will see sensors and actuators. Thank you for your cooperation.